Hey guys, in this video I wanted to go over how I do VBM or voxel-based morphometry. The first thing I want to get to is all the programs that I use. So if you don't have any of the programs, you can pause the video and download them. With the exception of MATLAB, which you need a subscription for, all the programs are free. So I use MATLAB, I use SPM, and as I'm making the video, I have all the up-to-date versions of these programs, but maybe in the future they'll get updated and this video will be out of date. But just get the latest version of SPM, which for me is SPM 12. Then, probably most importantly for this video, I'm using this program called CAT12, and this is another free program. I'll put the link in the description box below where you can download the program. It's from a university in Germany, and it really makes it simple to do VBM. You can also do something called DBM, which if you have a longitudinal study design, you might want to look into that. And you can also do something called SPM, all using the same program. It makes it really, really simple because I think even SPM has its own way of doing VBM, but I like using the CAT12 method better because I think it makes it even easier. Another thing that I really like about it is that it has a manual if you go to the website, and this manual is 44 pages. It gives you a step-by-step tutorial or manual of how to do all the processes, so VBM or DBM or SBM. And this is actually what I used to teach myself how to do VBM, so really you don't have to watch the video, you can just go to the link and teach it to yourself. But I think maybe the video will maybe help someone, I don't know. Anyway, so I highly recommend though, if you're doing a study design that is different from the one I'm going to do in this video, you go ahead and look at the manual and look at all the different variables that you can customize to your own study design, and especially the statistics will probably be different from the way I'm doing it. So this manual is really good and I highly recommend you guys look through it. And then to look at the results, I use XJView, which is another free MATLAB program. If you download it and set the path correctly, this is what will pop up on your screen. And I already have a video that I'll put a link to as well of how I use XJView for looking at VBM results. So I already made that video and I'll put a link to it in the description box as well. And also to make the video a little bit shorter, I have all my results in a VBM folder, so I'm not really going to run the examples. Just to make it quicker, I'll pretend I'm running them and then just show you the results at the end. Okay, so the first thing you want to do for VBM is to get, if your files are DICOMs, then you want to just convert them to NIFTYs, and then you want to segment your data. To segment the data, I go to the CAT12 segment button. So I don't use the segment button in SPM, I use the one from CAT12. In this tutorial, you have to go back and forth. So some buttons you do use the CAT12 version, but you do still use some buttons from the SPM 12 GUI, so don't close this because you're going to use both. So you segment through CAT12. If you're familiar with SPM, it's kind of a similar GUI. So it gives you so many options that you can customize. A lot of these, especially if you're just running it for the first time, you're just going to keep the default ones, which I do a lot, but you just want to change a few things. So for the segmentation, you're going to see this GUI, and it's really similar to an SPM GUI in that you have a lot of options that you can change and customize, but it gives you default recommendations. And so you can look through all of these things and change them to however you want to change them. For example, I think if you're doing DBM, you do change this, but for now we just leave it as the default. The only thing it's asking you that you definitely need is the volumes. So you're going to input the Nifty volumes, as many files as you have to process in here. So you're going to need to segment all your data through this. So put in all your control files and all your patient files through the segmentation of CAT12. This option, split job into separate processes, I think it looks at your computer, and I don't know if it looks at the threading of your computer or what, but I actually just always change this to zero because on my work computer it doesn't work if I try to use separate cores or whatever. But if you guys know more about computers than me, maybe you know how to get that to work. So for example, it gave you an option of two. If you want to try it with the default, whatever number it gives you, if that doesn't doesn't work, then if you switch it to 0, it will work. So if for some reason on my work computer, it doesn't work. If I just use the default, which on my work computer, it was 4. But if you change it to 0, then it will run each file individually instead of trying to split the job, and that will work. So you put in all the files, and then what that does is it will create gray matter and white matter files that are separated, and these are Nifty files. So if you go to whatever folder you had your Nifty files in, so this is an example of data I was inputting, and then it will create an MRI folder, and you will have what are called MWP1 files, and so these are gray matter files. It will have MWP2 files, and it will have white matter files. So it segments gray and white matter, and then the next step that you want to do is you want to smooth the data. So to smooth the data, you go to the SPM 12 GUI and you click the smoothing button. Then what you're going to do is you're smoothing the gray matter files. So you're going to smooth the MWP1 files. And again, you want to do this the same smoothing kernel for all your subjects. So you put in all the Nifty MWP1s into this file. So you click it and then you click done. And then for this is the smoothing kernel. So I think the Cat 12 manual recommends anywhere between 8 to 12 millimeter smoothing. I've tested it also with smaller kernels. So I've tested it with 3, for example, but you don't get better results just because you do less smoothing. Actually, I think it works best at about a kernel of 8. So I recommend doing 8 as well. You have a lot of other options that you can change, but I usually just keep the defaults for a lot of these things. This, for example, will tell you that it's appending the letter S to the files once it's smoothed. So after you run this in your MRI folder, now you're going to have smoothed, so SMWP1 files. So if you click it now, you're going to see, and this is with an 8 millimeter smoothing kernel. So you have the smooth gray matter files for all your patients and all your controls. And also, so I wasn't saying this because I wasn't running it, but the segment data, that takes about 10 minutes per file. So that is the longest thing from this tutorial. Everything else should run really quickly. So the smoothing, it should be done pretty much instantly, and all the other steps are done pretty much instantly. The segmentation is the only thing that takes a little while. After your data is smooth, then you're going to be able to create a statistical model. And so you use the Cat12 basic model button. For this, again, you're going to want to look at the manual and pick your own study design. I do, and this is, again, not really even a good design, but I do one patient and I compare them to a group of controls. But I do that more as like exploratory data analysis and just to confirm that I'm getting clusters in the same location as other tests for these patients. So these are epilepsy patients and we're trying to find basically where they have a problem in the brain. Usually for epilepsy, it's in the hippocampus, but it could be anywhere technically. So the location is really what I care about, and that's why I can do it that way. But if you're comparing, for example, a group of patients versus a group of controls, you might want to do a more advanced test than just a t-test. You can do f-tests on here, and it really depends on how you want to do the study design. So for this, the first thing it's going to ask you is for a directory. So what I do is in my VBM folder, I'd create a results folder, as you can see. So you can say results of an F test, whatever, and that's what it's asking you for the directory. So you put in the folder location where you want it to output all the results. That's here. Then for design, like I was just saying, you want to pick your design. So for me, I always do 2-sample t-test. Then I would put one file here. So if you have a patient group and a control group, then in your group ones, you want to put in all the files that were your smoothing files. So let me just pretend that I'm going to do it. So if I go to desktop, VBM, patients, MRI, then I'm going to put in all my smoothing files. It tells me I have 3 files. Then I have a control folder where I have all my controls. So I click all the smooth gray matter for my controls. And then the next thing you want to make sure you have is a covariate. So if you read the manual, it will tell you that it strongly recommends, practically requires, if you're going to do VBM, that you have at least one covariate. And the covariate has to be total intracranial volume. So you can definitely do a study where you have more than one covariate, depending on your design, but you want to have at least one, and you want to make sure you include TIV as a covariate almost always. So, and it tells you in the manual that you want no centering, and for me, it's going to be no interactions. So it's asking you to input a vector of your covariates. So what you have to do is, Cat12 actually has a button that says estimate TIV. Again, for me, I don't know if I was just doing something wrong, but it didn't work when I tried to use the button, so I had to do it manually. What I do is I manually created a text file. So if I open that here, you see I have a text file full of numbers, and the way I do it is that this number, the first line I have is for my one patient, and then these are all an ordered list of the TIV I have for controls. So the way you would make a file like this is that every time you do segmentation, there's also a report folder, and this will give you XML files for each patient and also PDFs of each patient. And it has a report of the image quality, and more importantly, it will give you the TIV numbers. So allegedly, the estimate TIV button should be able to extract the TIV information automatically, but it wasn't working when I used the button. If you know how to program, you might be able to write a program that extracts information from the XML files, but I haven't done that, and I've just been doing it manually. Really, if you do it once, then when I update it, all I have to do is change the first line for each new patient. So it's not a big deal to update it manually, except you just have to do it the first time, and that takes a little bit of time. So if you go to each report, all you have to do is look here, and it will tell you the total intracranial volume for each subject, and you just want to make sure you write a text file where you're sure that the inputs of your files are the same order as your text file. So you want to make sure the covariate data is matching up to each file correctly, and the way I do that is just by making sure all my file names have the initials of the patients first, and so that will be put in alphabetical order, so I can be sure that each time I do it, I'm also creating a file with alphabetical order, if that makes sense. So after you create that text file manually, then let me show you how you load it into your GUI. So you want to go to your MATLAB terminal and then go to the folder where you have your text file. So for me, it's here and I can see it in my current folder window. Then you want to go to the terminal and type load TIV and the name of your text file. And I've already done that, but once you click enter, if you go to the workspace window, it should show you that you have a vector and it will give you the dimensions of the vector. So mine is 34 by 1. And I always just like to double check that when I type in the number of files I have here, that this number equals the number that I have here. So if, for example, here I have a 36 and I have a 34 here. So that would mean that I'm missing two files from my covariate list. So you just want to make sure the numbers match up, or else you're not going to have a correct covariance between the files and the total intracranial volume. After you've loaded that into your workspace, then you can go to vector, specify, and what you're going to type here is the name of your file. So for me, it's that. Then I do open parentheses, then semicolon, comma, one. So once I click OK, that will open up a vector that's 34 by 1 doubles, and it will have all the information of the total intracranial volumes for all the subjects. Then, like I said, we already do no centering. I get this information just from the manual, so it says to do absolute masking, and then you want to set the threshold. So you can do 0.01 or 0.02. 0.02 obviously is a little bit of a higher threshold. I usually just do 0.01 and that works fine. And then again, I don't change any of the following defaults. And then once that's done, you can click the green arrow and that will run. Once that's finished running, that creates an spm.mat file in your results folder. And what you're going to do is you're going to want to estimate that. And so you have to go to the SPM GUI, click estimate, then you click your spm.mat file. And again, I don't change any of these defaults. You click the green button and that will run. Once that's done running, you have to click results and you have to set your T or F contrasts. So again, it's going to ask you to input your SPM mat file. Once you do that, this little box will pop up. And again, depending on how you want to do your statistics, you're going to set a T or F contrasts. I always put whatever here. For me, I usually do negative 1 and 1. And you click submit and you click OK. Then you click done. That will run really quickly and then that will show the results on a window here. Again, for me, I don't look at the results through the SPM GUI. I use a program called XJView. And so you'll be ready to use that once you're finished with the results button. So you go to XJView. After you click results, it will create a file that's basically, for me, it's a TMAP. You can go to open images and it will be in your results folder. So it creates all these files. The one I load in is SPMT_0001. You click done and then that will show you the results from your VBM. And again, I have a tutorial video already on how you can get all the information from the results, the statistics, and how you use XJView in another video, so I'll put that link in the description box below. So that's it for this video. Thank you guys for watching.